Okay, today we are gonna start the chapter G. Basically, we're gonna start to talk about the torsion. So, just a little bit. Before we start, talk about it. So the first thing I want to mention, what's the difference between moment and
is moment the force and then torsion is the like reaction to the force?
No, the moment's not force. The moment is the force times the distance.
Yeah.
Let's put it versus torque. So, in terms of the formula, they both are the same. There's a force times distance. So, mathematically, if you look at it as a formula, they are the same. But so the formula is the same, the unit is the same, but they are not the same.
Moment is normally just on one side, so would torque be on both sides?
The moment can be on both sides as well. But what do you mean by direction?
Like, torque is like a twist. Moment's kind of more like that.
That's the difference. So the moment, usually, the moment is like that. If I have the element, and then I have the moment, so the moment, regardless of how I calculate it, is like this. So it wants to rotate it or bend it. Okay? So if I have a moment and this is my object, the moment would be bending. So it's the force times distance, but it would bend it. So that's the moment. On the other hand, the torque wants to torque wants to twist it. See? So the torque twist, the moment bent. Twist, bent. So that's the difference between them. As I said, the formula wise they are the same, the unit wise they are the same. So there's a force times distance, but one of them bend or object or cause the rotation. For example, if I open the door, the force that I put on the door handle caused the door to rotate about its axis, correct? But any shaft in the car, if you see any shaft in the car, is going under the twist. So that's the difference between the moment and the torque. So you got that? Now, if you have an object goes under the torque, we put the torque on that object. if you have a red clothes, let's go, and one pair of sides, you get one end and you get one end, and you start to twist it in different direction until you squeeze it so all the water goes out. That caused your clothes to squeeze it like this is a torsion. So if you have anything, any object, and you rotate it over its longitudinal axis like this, it's a torsion. Later on we're going to talk about the other form of that, but that's my axis and I twist it over that. This is called a torsion. So we want to see that if I go ahead and do that, what happened inside that object. So one step going back. In the previous chapter, I was looking at if I pressure it or stretch it, what happened? Got it? Now I want to see if I twist it, what happened? And in other chapter, we'll look at other deformation that you put on the object. So what happened? Some objects at the same time, at the very end of the book, we'll look at the combination of all these things that we look at. Some objects, some elements might go under a couple of them. So you might have an element that is under pressure and twist at the same time. Some of them, no, they might not go under all of them at the same time. Might be under pressure or twist or other one at the same time. So we are going to go through them one by one, and then at the end, we'll put them all together. So previous chapter, compressor tension. This chapter, we start to look at the torsion, or basically if we twist an object. And in entire chapter, we look on the circular cross-section. We can use it later on for if the cross-section is not circular, but it's going to be more complicated. It's easier to see what happened on circular cross-section. So we focus on circular cross-section for now to see if we twist it, what happened. So if I have an object like this, and then I have a torque applying on both ends of that. Like this. If I go ahead and cut it somewhere in between the half, because the entire idea is that I want to see what's happened inside that element or object. Like the previous one, we cut it in the half, we look at the normal or shear force to see if we can find the normal or shear stress. Now, what if I'm gonna cut it somewhere there? I'm gonna cut it in the half somewhere there, and I keep the left part of that. So if I... I have that. And then I have this T here. So the internal force in that section there, how should it look like?
It will have changed or like moved the least comparatively. If we're moving both ends, the spot in the middle will have moved the least, but otherwise it will compress on itself more.
But assume it's like that, so no part is moving any further. So I just cut it in half and I want to analyze the internal force. So the internal force we learned was the normal force, shear force, and bending moment. Is there going to be any normal force there? If I put a normal force there, then it starts to move. Correct?
Yeah.
correct? So it cannot be a normal force. If I put the bending moment there, again, it starts to rotate because there's no bending moment to balance that. What about the shear? So if there is no bending moment, if this is not a normal, there should be something should balance that torque. Because I have a torque, and something should balance that. If the normal doesn't balance that, if the moment doesn't balance that, so the only one left that should balance that is gonna be the shear. So there should be a shear on that surface to balance that force. So if I go ahead and say, hey, look, I'm gonna look at the element there. Small element. And then it's gonna be the center. There's going to be the shear stress on that point. I call it the DF. So the DF is there, and then this distance is very common. So this distance is rho. Now, first, let's look at if I have that element. Gonna make it larger. And if this is a DF on that, how much is the DF? Using the definition of the shear stress.
Force divided by area.
Force what?
Force divided by area. So, and then also you need to add the angle.
So don't forget about the angle, assume it's normal.
Force times area.
So it's going to be force times area or?
Force divided by area.
Force divided by area gives you the
shear
stress. Now I want the force. So it's gonna be a stress times area. Agree? So I can kind of write the DF is tau DA. Now, come back here. I want this force, or all the forces smaller like that, balance that T. So if I want to, what's the torque of that force respect to the center? The torque is always force times distance, like the moments, the equation is the same. Okay, so it's a force times distance. For the torque, the distance is always some kind of the radius wise distance because we are twisting. So, can I say that this torque here should be equal to adding all these df times the rho. So kind of go as it is, it's going to be rho times df and add them all together. So rho times df is gives me the d, or the torque created by the df. Now if I add them all together, it should balance that torque. Agree? Now if I replace the df from there, and I go ahead and say it's gonna be equal to rho tau dA. Sorry, that's the tall nut. Can I write that? That is the shear stress created by the torque. So if I put the torque T on that object, the shear stress created is going to be tall. It's gonna, for the circular section that we have, is gonna be simplified a lot. So, but conceptual is that. The equation is gonna be simpler than that. But I want you to get the concept of what happened here. So if I put the torque T, it's gonna create the shear stress on that surface, which the torque created by that shear stress is gonna balance that outside torque. So the internal torque from the shear stress would be balanced the external torque that we put on that object. Got it? So, as I said, we are not going to use that equation. We just want, I want to make sure that you know the concept what's happening there. Now, have you ever put the bunch, I don't know how to call it, open a bag of a spaghetti and put all of them together? And have you tried to break them by twisting them? And you look at it, when you twist them, the spaghetti starts to move in this direction. So you twist it and spaghetti go all the way horizontal. Why they move horizontal when you twist it? Because if you twist it, it shouldn't go horizontal, it just should twist and break at the middle. But you know that if you don't hold it very hard, the spaghetti start to move at both end.
Or, since you're moving both ends oppositely, the middle is having a lot of force applied to it. And so either...
So I agree. If you twist it, we have that shear force in the middle that caused it to break. But why it moves like this?
Assuming your grip is just stronger on one side.
We don't have any. If it moves that way, there should be a force that way. Do you have force that way? But it moves that way, so there should be a force that way. Otherwise, how can it move? So we agree that there is a force that way that causes it to move, but it's not normal.
Is it the moment?
The moment bend doesn't cause the horizontal move. If it was a moment, the spaghetti should like become like this. So let's go back to the shear. When we talk about the shear and we draw the shear, it says that If you have a shear on one surface, you should have the shear on the other surface as well. You remember that? And I draw the element of the shear. I said that if I have a shear on one end, to balance that, I have to have a shear there. Correct? Now it starts to rotate. To balance the rotate, I have to have the shear there. And to balance that, I have to have the shear there. So I cannot have the shear only on one surface, ever. So it means that if I have a shear on that surface, on the normal surface, I have to have the shear perpendicular to that as well. If I have it on the normal surface, I have to have a shear on the horizontal surface as well. And that's why when you twist it, you create a vertical shear stress. And because you create a vertical shear stress, the vertical shear stress cannot be there by its own. You should have the horizontal shear stress as well. And that horizontal shear stress caused them to go the other way. And you can try it at home the next time. So if you have that object there, and if I go there, and somehow I go ahead and draw strip on that, so make sure that this day make it horizontal. If I go ahead and put two colors of them stick, two colors there, so it's a stick. Red color there. Assume the blue color underneath of it. And then I go ahead and twist it. If I go ahead at this, okay, I have the same thing. And this time I'm gonna twist it, so I put some torque on it. I'm gonna twist. If I twist that, the line I'm not going to draw it perfectly, but the lines will start to look like this. And then, if you look at that red and blue, you will see that red is goes there. And the blue goes somewhere here. They're gonna like that. So under torsion there is shear stress on both cross section and and that surface shear stress is the one that caused that separation between these two colors. You have a big one, the next time if you have a spaghetti, just try it before it breaks, you will see that they are moving away. Or if you have a bunch of, for example, the popsicle stick, or some stick of wood, put them together and start to twist it, and you'll see they are moving horizontally, and that's because of that shear that we are having on the surface of. So, any question about the torsion, where that shear stress come from, and why we have the shear stress on both cross section and the surface of the object? Conceptual, before we slowly just...
But just to clarify, so it's a shear stress because it's like on the edge of the thing, and it's also like parallel to it. It, otherwise, if it were to be at like the end, that would make it a normal force. Okay.
So, basically, if I have that, if the force is like that, that's a normal. If the force is there, it's the shear.
Okay. This doesn't really matter, but when you bend a spaghetti like that, it will normally break into three pieces because the shockwave of it breaking will break the middle section into a third, and so to break it into strictly two pieces, you have to bend it as you're doing it, because the bending force will help snap it before the shockwave of it snapping will break off into a third piece. So if you bend it as you're giving the moment, it'll stay in two pieces. Mm. Some students at college actually did like a full-on research paper on it.
Can you break the entire thing? I haven't tried. Can you break them just two? I'm not strong enough, but can you break it just by twisting it?
I don't think with a bundle of it, no, just because it would, like, they would just rub on each other. Like, you wouldn't be able to get a good enough grip.
Yeah. Sure.
It should be break, but I said to probably have to be real, real strong too. Do that.
Yeah, my grip strength probably just doesn't come like that.
So that's the torsion itself. Now let's look at the deformation. So that's basically the shear stress. So we know that if we put anything under the torsion, there is no bending, there is no axial stretch or compression or contraction. So basically there's no normal force. And there's the shear stress. Now let's look at how it looks like for the deformation, how it deforms basically. And so deformation under torsion. As I said, we are only keep looking at the circular cross section, so we're not worried about the other stuff for now. So if I go ahead and say I have a, let's see if I can draw it. A shaft like this. And then I go ahead and draw a central line, AB. Draw a line from center to center, horizontal line. And now I will go ahead and twist it. So if I go ahead B stays there, and the A. If I twist it like that, I have it. If I put a torque like that on that, where the A goes? So A goes up. What about the B? Stays there. So if I said it's a B, I say that it goes like this to the point, and I'll go ahead and call that point A prime. So now if I go ahead and from the very center, I connect two line. So assume this is the center there. Connect that. And did I connect it there as well? So from the very center, I draw two lines from A to A prime. So that angle there is angle of east. And it is in radian. So remember that any angle we use in this chapter always radian. So this is also one other point that one said. For circular shaft subjected to torsion, every cross section has to remain flat. Every cross section remain plain and flat. So after the torsion is not that the, if this is my cross section, after the torsion, it just stay the same. It just rotate, but it's the same. So it's not rotate and then suddenly become like this or become like this. So if it is flat before, it's gonna stay flat after I twist it. Okay, so it's not becoming like this or any other form. It stay flat. So this angle, this angle is the central angle of the twist, and this is the one that we are going to use in many of the equations. Now, subjected to the twist, and there is a there's already a Y in there. I'm gonna call this distance from here to here C. Now, here's where it gets a little bit. If I go ahead and you see that red, 1. If I go ahead and cut that red one out and bring it out, this is where the original shaft is sitting. And then I have the red one is going from here. That the same as I'm going to draw the same AB line here, so it's going to go here to here. So, if I have an A and goes, the A goes from there to that A prime point. This time I'm gonna consider this distance as a distance distance from center to that red one, I'm gonna consider it as a rope. And this central angle here is still gonna be five, correct? So the central angle is gonna be five, doesn't matter how it's make it smaller or bigger, it's gonna be five. And then this one here, this angle here, so if I have that, there are a couple of equations that I can write between them. And the first one is that the gamma would be equal to rho phi divided by L. Here, the gamma is, remember what that? Shear strain. That's the gamma. Rho is distance from center. Is angle of twist radian, and L is the x. So if rho is the rho is equal to the c, then gamma becomes gamma max. And therefore the gamma max equal to C Y divided by L. And again, the C is radius. So then you can write that in the form of gamma is equal rho divided by C gamma max. So we have these three equations about the deformation of the this one. So these are basically showing the deformation of that shape. So the gamma or the shear strength is just know that this is the angle here, the phi is the angle of twist here, and then these two I'm gonna again write. This is very important in the entire books, and it's like that. This C is the radius, and the rho is distance from center. So in other words, the rho max is the C. So this is about the deformation. So any question about them? Next, I want, so if this is a deformation, next I want to say, okay, this, how much is that shear stress caused by the torsion? That's a deformation caused by the torsion. So if I have, if I want to see what's the deformation caused by the torsion, so that's the relationship with the deformation that I have, and then I want to see what would be, how much would be the shear stress caused by the torsion? just want to see, okay, if we have a torsion, how much would be the stress that we have? You know that, so we have that, remember, we have the tau is, and then we have the gamma there, so we have the shear strain from there. So if I can go and put in that equation and rewrite that equation, do all the rest. So the tau would be rho divided by C tau max. Then the tau max would be equal to TC divided by J, and the tau would be in the same manner T rho divided by J. So here, rho distance from center, C the radius. And J is the polar moment of inertia. We had in the statics, I'm just going to very quickly remind you about it. For the circular cross section, if I have a cross section like this, and that's going to be the R, so it's the circle. The J would be 1/2 of pi r to the fourth. If I have a
same color.
If I have a hollow circle, so there's a shaft that's there's an empty space in the middle of that, so it's gonna be look like this. And there's an empty space inside that. And then I have going to be the R max. And then I have the so the the distance to the inside wall is the R min, the distance to the outside wall is the R max. Okay? Then in that case, the J would be half of P R max the 4 minus half of I R mean the 4, or basically the J is usually they write it like that, half of the pi R max the 4 minus R mean the 4. Will they write it like this? So if you want to remember how we calculate it, can go back. We did in the statics. Now, if I want to look at it and see how that shear is actually distributed, so if I was this stress. So if I have a full circle again, and then I said, okay, this is the I flipped it from the book. I think the book have the tall there and row there. I flipped it. I think it's easier to understand it this way. Well, you have the maximum tall there. And it goes to the zero at the center. So it's max at the surface, and it becomes zero at the center.
If you have the
hollow circle or shaft, have again the same two tall and the row. Again, I would have the tall max here. That's the tall max, and that's going to be the tall mean, and then from there. And then from there to be zero because it's hollow. I'm gonna change it to other color, maybe it's easier to see. So that's the part, the red part is there. The tall mean is the C mean or C max divided by tall max. If you can have that example, that is the C. So shear stress is distributed linear. So it's a linear. Okay, from the center to the surface is linearly changing. Okay? Shear stress is zero at the center, and then the shear stress is maximum at the surface. shear stress distribution under the torsion. Conceptually, as you look at it, formula-wise, it's very simple. It has a very simple formula, but conceptually, it can become a little bit confusing. So as long if you get what's happening, the problem is relatively very simple because it's a very simple formula to use. So I'm gonna do one example, and then probably I stop because things are gonna be too much. But let's look at a simple, very simple example. See how we can work it. It says that if you have the hollow shaft. It's gonna be 1.5 meter. So it says that what's the largest torque that can be applied to shaft if the shear is not. So if you have the tau max, so if the tau max is 120 megapascal, then the T. And then, so basically, that's it. What's the T and what's the tau mean? So if I know that the tall max should be
smaller than that,
so it should not, or in other words, it says that the tall max should be smaller or equal to that. So that our tall max, we don't want it to be more than that values. Then how much would be the maximum torque I can put on that? And when I have that maximum torque, how much would be the minimum? So what's the first step?
And the moment of inertia?
The first step, you have to find the J. So find the polar moment of the inertia. Oh, J. So it's the hollow, so it's empty in the between, so it's gonna be the J would be half of pi. R max minus R min. So the J is half of pi. How much the R max? 20 millimeters. The fourth. So the J would be 'Polar moment of inertia, the force. Now, the next step is that how much is the tau, how much the T max? So I have that equation. So the T, the tau max and the T is gonna be tau max is equal to T and become the C divided by G. That to be 120 megapascal. And the 6 should be equal to T max, and the C is radius. So now that I have the tau, so that's the maximum tau that I'm gonna have. How much the tau mean? Question?